الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعماه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون الذي بعدا فلا يرى وقربا فشهد النجوى تبارك وتعالى والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين سيدنا ونبينا بالقاسم محمد ولأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم رجسا وطهرهم تطهيرا واللانة الدائمة الباقية لعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم وغاصب حقوقهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط وأنزلنا الحديد فيه بأس شديد ومنافع للناس صلوات من الله We've gathered to commemorate the shahadat of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Imam al-Muttaqeen, Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. I began on the eve of 19th with the ayat of Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the purpose for sending the Ambiyah and Mursaleen. And one of the important purpose that Allah mentions in that surah is the concept of justice in the society. Inshallah, we'll continue that theme even tonight. But let me begin with the introductory remarks that I have made, that to understand the personality of Amir al-Mu'mineen, we have to understand that he is not just a Khalifa, or an imam, just in that sense. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had blessed our Prophet with two miracles. One was the Quran, and the other was Ali bin Abi Talib, alayhi salatu wa salam. When you look at the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the message of Allah is condense, it takes the form of the Quran. And when the same message is expanded, you see that in the form of Ali bin Abi Talib. There is no difference in that. The only difference is that this is a book and this is a living person. You know, popularly we use this term in the Shi'i societies, where we talk about the Kitabullah, we say this is Quran as-Samit. It is a silent book. When we talk about Ali, we say he is Quran natiq. He is the speaking Quran. You might not find the exact wordings in that way, but you will see even in Siffin, when the army of Muawiyah put the Quran on their spearheads to deceive this people of Iraq, Amir al-Mu'mineen said, you go and fight, even if you have to strike on that Quran, because this is just kitab, bayna daffatayn. This is a book between the two covers, it cannot speak. La budda lahu min turjaman. This book needs a spokesperson, and I am the spokesman of the Quran. And so you have the Quran as the book, and Ali is the one who speaks about it. In one of the khutbas in Nahj al-Balagha, khutbah number 158, he talks about Quran, where he says, this is the nur that Allah has sent through the Prophet for your guidance. And then he says, فَاسْتَنْتِقُوهُ. Try to make the Quran talk to you. He's first of all challenging us. This is a nur for you. This is a guidance for you. And try to make it speak to you. لَنْ يَنْتِقْ. It is a book. It will not speak to you. وَلَكِنْ أُخْبِرُكُمْ عَنْهُ. come to me, I will let you know what the Quran is. And so when we talk about this concept of message of Allah coming in a condensed form in Quran, in an expanded form in the life of Amir al-Mu'mineen, we are not doing ghulu or exaggeration. This is the reality. And that is why we consider the Quran to be the universal book. And on the same level, we say Ali is a universal person. As the Quran is not bound by time and space, Ali, his life, his ideas, his examples are not bound by time and space. I read to you one example from one of the Christian Lebanese writers. Let me present to you another one. Suleiman Katani had written a book about Amir al-Mu'mineen, a very famous book which was translated by Dr. Howard. And the English translation is Imam Ali, Source of Light, Wisdom, and Might. There he, you know, describes this same phenomena in his own very poetic way. He says, and I quote here, 14 centuries with their hours, days, and years have dissolved like the grain of salt dissolves in the palm of the ocean. Yet not a letter of your great name has dissolved. The Ayn, the Lam, and the Ye from your name is still there. The words that have come from your lips have constantly refused for 14 centuries to be limited to time or space, because they carry from you the light of true values of thoughts and struggles for the reality of life. They cannot be confined to any one framework. Whatever perspective you look at Amir al-Mu'mineen, you will see you cannot confine him. There's quite a lot to say about it. Just look at within the Islamic, you know, history. All the branches of Islamic sciences, you will see each one of them, they trace their chain of students and teachers. All of them go back to Ali. Whether it is jurisprudence, fiqh, or you talk about eloquence and Arabic grammar and literature, you talk about theology, you talk about philosophy, you know, and even spirituality, whatever area of Islamic sciences that you pick, study the history of those sciences, you will see Ali is the fountain of those sciences. But tonight I would like to again go back to this concept, which is itself is a universal concept. And Ali became one with it. And that is the concept of adl and qist and justice. He became an embodiment of universal justice that even now, you know, the world needs a person like Ali, or at least his ideas and thoughts, in order to bring about betterment in the human society, especially in the Ummah. But let me begin, before I go to one or two aspects of it, from an ayat of Quran, emphasizing this theme of justice. In Surah An-Nisa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كونوا قوامين بالقسط شهداء لله. All you who believe, be maintainers of justice and fairness, and be witness for the sake of Allah. Be just and fair, ولو على أنفسكم أو الوالدين والأقربين. Be just in your conduct, in your testimony, even if it goes against yourself, or against your parents, or against those who are related to you. In yakun ghaniyan aw faqiran, shouldn't matter whether the other person, your opponent, is a rich or a poor, or the person for whom you are testifying is rich or poor, it shouldn't matter. Fallahu awla bihima, Allah is better than anyone else. Be on the side of Allah, which is the side of justice. فَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا الْهَوَىٰ أَن تَعْدِلُوا. Do not let your desires overcome you to refrain from adl and justice. وَإِن تَلُونَ. If you turn away from it and ignore it, تُعْرِضُوا. فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ بِمَا كَانَ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ. Then Allah knows what you do. and he is going to hold you accountable for it on the Day of Judgment. So this sense of justice starts from within. Even if it is going against us, we have to act according to justice. Even if it goes against those who are near and dear to us, doesn't matter. Because that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants for us, from us. And on the Day of Qiyamah, He is going to ask about our conduct, whether it was on the basis of justice or not. If you look at the example of Amirul Mu'mineen, and I would like to look at two different situations. One is about the concept of justice in distribution of Baytul Maal. Baytul Maal is the public revenue of the Islamic government. And the other is the conduct of Amirul Mu'mineen when he dealt with those who were the other, the opponents and the enemies. Look at the Muslim world, where is it going? You know, we don't have tolerance. Don't even talk about brotherhood. They're still far away. We don't even have the sense of tolerating the differences between one another. Amir al-Mu'mineen talks about it, and we'll come to the example later on. But first, let us talk about the distribution in Baytul Maal. Ali became a Khalifa at the insistence of the people 25 years after the wafat of Rasulullah. And he was actually, you know, it's interesting that if you look at the history, the day his bay'at was done, where people pledged their allegiance to him, it was the day of Ghadeer, but 25 years after the actual Ghadeer. It took Muslims 25 years to cross that distance from the Ghadeer of Rasulullah to the Ghadeer on that day. But they came to him, and Ali was saying, I don't want to be your Khalifa, because you will not be able to tolerate what I'm going to bring for you. You have been so much corrupted. You are used to corruption in the government system that when I talk about what is haq and what is batil, you will not like it. He uses the term, he says, Inni hamilukum ala minhaj nabiyikum. He says, I am going to take you on the path of your prophet. It means in the 25 years, they had deviated from the path, the minhaj of Nabi. They were not on the path of Rasulullah. And Ali says, I'm going to bring you back to that path, especially when it comes to the issue of social justice in distribution of Baytul Maal. The minhaj of Rasul, the path of Rasul, the sunnat of Rasul, was that he would treat all the people equally when it came to distribution of Baytul Maal. He didn't, you know, discriminate between Arab and non-Arabs, or black and white, masters and slaves, no. He treated them equally. Unfortunately, later on things change, especially in the administration of the second Khalifa, where the Arabs were given, you know, more share than the non-Arab Muslims. The non-Arabs were known as Mawali. They were second-class citizens of the Muslim empire. Even among the Arabs, the Quraishi was preferred over the others in distribution of Baytul Maal. Even the wives of the Prophet was not given equally. There were some preferred than the others. And when you come to the third Khilafat, you know, this, it alienated many people because now the privileges were confined to the tribe of Banu Umayyah, the tribe of the Khalifa. And that is why you see this, you know, opposition to the Khalifa all the way from Egypt to Medina and Medina to Kufa. Almost the entire Muslim empire of the time, other than Syria, which was under the control of Muawiyah, who was part of the family of the Khalifa. And it was their protest and, you know, opposition to the Khalifa which ended up in the situation where the third Khalifa was killed. And when you look at that, this is where you see that when Amir al-Mu'mineen is now accepted by the people as a Khalifa, the very first speech he gave, what do you call the inaugural, you know, speech of the new leader. Look at the wordings he uses. He says, well, and I'm just, you know, not going to the Arabic. We don't want to prolong the timing here. He says, well, Any man from the Muhajirin and Ansar who thinks that he is superior to others because of his companionship to Rasulullah, because he is a Sahabi, then let him remember that the shining superiority is tomorrow in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your ajr and reward will be with Allah. So don't expect from me to give you more just because you are a companion of Rasulullah. Anyone, and this is where he comes to, he says, anyone who answered the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger, accepted the truth of our religion, entered into it, and faced our Qibla, is entitled to all the rights and is bound by all its limits. Anyone who says the kalima, accepts Islam, stands by our Qibla, he is like anyone else. And then he says, Antum ibadullah wal mal malullah. You are all servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this wealth that you see in Baytul Maal, the treasury of the Muslim government, this is Maal of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It will be distributed among you on the basis of equality. There is no preference for one over the other. Salawat. This is just a policy statement. Then a day comes when Amir al-Mu'minin decides to distribute the Maal which is there in Baytul Maal. And even there, he gives a speech. He says, O people, verily Adam did not give birth to a slave, male or female. All people are born free. However, some of you have been blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than others. So there is a difference in your economic financial status. Let it be known that something from the revenue of the public treasury is present here, and we shall distribute it equally between the black and the white. And then the distribution started. Remember, these people are used to the privileges of the previous administrations. The Arabs against non-Arabs, the Sahaba against non-Sahaba, the Quraishi against non-Quraishi, the masters against the slaves. And so one of the Ansar by the name of Sahal bin Hunayf came forward, and he was given 3 dirham. That was given to everyone. After him, his formal slave came in the line after him. He also got 3 dirhams. Sahal bin Hunayf didn't like it. He felt humiliated and insulted. He comes to Amir al-Mu'minin and says, you know, you're treating me and my former slave as on the same level? And that is where Amir al-Mu'minin looks at him and says, I looked at the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I didn't see any difference between the children of Ibrahim, whether from Ismail or Ishaq. Why do you think you are more superior to your former slave? I didn't see any distinction there. So you will get same as what he got. This is Ali. This is the justice of Ali that he was saying, you will not be able to bear my justice, the minhaj of Nabi that I'm going to take you on to. This was at that time. How close we are to that minhaj of Nabi and Ali. Do we treat people around ourselves in the same way? Or do we look at the issue of the tribes? Speaks my language? Comes from my part of the world? Huh? This is not Jahiliyyah. This is Islam. This is the mazhab of Ali. This is tashayyu'. Let us return to the spirit of justice and equality when we treat one another in the view of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. One of the first ones who did bay'at at the hand of Ali were two individuals by the name of Talha and Zubair. They were actually the leaders of opposition against Muawiyah. And then when Ali was made the Khalifa, they were the first one to do bay'at. However, when they did the bay'at, In their minds, it was conditional that we will get certain privileges. And both of them were looking for governorship of one province or the other. And Amir al-Mu'mineen didn't really consider them worthy of that. So they came to him and complained. We'll leave those issues later on, but one of the complaints was they said that in the matter of distribution of Baytul Maal, you are going against the policy of Umar ibn Khattab. He used to, you know, give us privileges compared to others, which we are the Sahaba. And Amir al-Mu'mineen responds to them by bringing the ayat of Quran and the sunnah of the Prophet. And at the end he says, أَفَ سُنَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أَوْلَى بِالْعِطِّبَاءِ أَمْ سُنَّةِ عُمَرِ He says, what is worthy to be followed here? The sunnah of Rasulullah or the sunnah of Umar? And they had no arguments there. But this is where we see the difference between the policy of Amir al-Mu'mineen. And that is the reason why, when we are asked, why do you prefer the Ahlul Bayt? Sometimes the labels become very, you know, misleading. A Sunni means somebody who follows the Sunnah of Rasulullah. A Shia, as if he doesn't follow the Sunnah of Rasulullah. No, we follow the Sunnah of Rasulullah, but we look for the channel which is secure and direct and pure. For us, the Minhaj of Nabi, the Sunnah of Rasul, comes from the path of Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. Salawat alaykum. Dr. Tijani, one of the Tunisian scholars who was a Sunni previously, is very, very well known for his book, Then I Was Guided, where he talks about his own spiritual journey towards the Ahlul Bayt. One of his books is very interesting. He gives the title, he says, "Ash-Shia hum Ahlus Sunnah." The Shia are the true followers of the Sunnah. Because if you look at this, this is a very serious issue of society when you talk about Baytul Maal, when justice. And Ali says, I'm going to take you on the Minhaj of Nabi. Here he's saying, do you prefer Sunnah of Rasulullah or the Sunnah of others? And this shows us very clearly that when you follow the Ahlul Bayt, you are actually following the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. The main opposition in Jamal and then Siffin was all because of these issues. Same Talha Zubair and then turned against Ali. They became the leaders all along with Aisha in the Battle of Jamal. This brings me to another part of the justice of Amir al-Mu'mineen, and that is about how to deal with the other. Those who don't like you, who are not in agreement with you. And let me start with the ayat of Quran from Surah Maidah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again emphasizing the point of justice, where he says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu kunu qawwamina lillah shuhada'a bilqist. O you who believe, be maintainers of justice in witnessing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the statement, وَلَا يَجْرِمَنَّكُمْ شَنَعَانُ قَوْمٍ أَنْ لَا تَعْدِلُوا Allah says, let not the hatred of a people force you to abandon justice. It means it might be a situation where people have been, you know, unjust to you. They have done things to you that really you rightfully have hatred towards them. But he says, even then, even if you don't like somebody who has been bad to you, you know, be just. This hatred should not push you to be unjust with them. اعدلوا هو أقرب للتقوى. Be just. That is closer to taqwa and piety. واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. Fear Allah. Allah is all aware of what you do. In both ayats here is saying, I know what you do. And I'm going to question you on the day of Qiyamah about it. You look at the Battle of Jamal. We are not going to the story here, but the way Amir al-Mu'minin, even there, doesn't allow the historians to say that Ali initiated the hostilities. He first wanted to resolve the problem on a peaceful manner, avoid bloodshed. He sends Abdullah bin Abbas, a prominent Sahabi, cousin of the Prophet, cousin of Ali. He gives him the Quran. He says, this is the Quran. Go to them. Apparently, you know, with a symbol that I'm coming to negotiate. Where we hear, for example, they carry a white flag. So it's not for fighting. So he goes there, talks to Talha and Zubair and Aisha, and he says, this is the Quran. Amir al-Mu'minin says, you have violated the bayat. You pledge allegiance to him as the Imam and the Khalifa, and now you have violated that. He is saying, let us sit down on the basis of this Quran and resolve the problem. And they basically abused him. They said, there's nothing but sword between us. To the extent that when he was coming back, they even shot arrows towards him. None of them hit him. But that was kind of the violence that they were showing. And Abdullah bin Abbas said, Amir al-Mu'minin, there's no time really to talk to them. Why don't we just start the war? And Ali said, no. He says, no, we'll appeal again to resolve this on the basis of the Quran. And now he says, he announces there, he says, I want a volunteer. يَا مَنْ يَأْخُذُ هَذَا الْمُصْحَفْ فَيَدْعُ إِلَيْهِ وَهُوَ مَقْتُولٌ وَأَنَا ضَامِنٌ لَهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْجَنَّةِ. He says, I'm looking for a volunteer. Is there anyone who will come? Take the Quran and ask them to settle on the basis of the judgment of the Quran. And even if that person is killed, I guarantee in the name of Allah, Jannat will be given to him. I don't think anyone else could give that guarantee. But someone who is known as Qasimun Nari wal Jannah. In the words of Imam Shafi, in his poetry, he says, Ali is Qasimun Nari wal Jannah, is the one who divides people into Jannat and Jahannam. Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal was asked by his students that, you know, what is your opinion about this statement about Ali, that he is Qasimun Nari wal Jannah? And he told them that, well, haven't you heard the words of Rasulullah, that where he says to Ali, that no one loves you but a mu'min, and no one hates you but a munafiq. And they said, yes, we heard this. Then Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal asked the students, he says, tell me, where will iman be and where will nifaq be? He says, well, that is jannat and this is jahannam. So well, that is what it means, qasimun nari wal jannah. Salawat pranayak barah. A young man stood up, very much sure about the guarantee that Ali has given. Ali looked at his youth and he said, no, sit down. Again he announced, is there anyone who will take the Quran and appeal to them to settle on the basis of Quran? And if he's killed, I am dhamin, I guarantee Jannah for him. Again he stood up. Again Amir al-Mu'minin said, sit down. Third time he stood up, Ali said, take it. He goes there, approaches the army of the opposition, and says, this is the Quran, let us settle down on this. They started shooting, you know, arrows and spears, throwing spears at him. Eventually they killed him. And he went to Jannah with the zamanat and guarantee of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Even then, Amir al-Mu'mineen said, we will not start the hostilities. Two other people were killed. It's only then Ali says, okay, this is enough. I have done my itmam hujjat. I tried my best to resolve this problem peacefully, but they want to fight. And when the war starts, he gives the instructions. Even then, see this sense of justice. He says, أيها الناس لا تقتلوا مدبرا ولا تجهز على جريح ولا تكشف عورة ولا تهيج امرأة ولا تمثل بقتيل. He says, "O people, do not kill the one who is running back, going away. Do not kill the wounded ones. Do not strip them of their clothes. Do not violate a woman, and do not mutilate the dead bodies." Even at that time when he is very angry, he sees what they are doing against me, still the sense of justice is there. Whether Ali is in the battlefield or mihrab, at home, with the people, wherever he is, adl and justice is always with Ali bin Abi Talib. Salawat. This is the minhaj and the sunnah of Rasulullah. The minhaj and the sunnah is not with the Salafis. It is not with these Wahhabis that we see, whether it's in Egypt, dragging the body of those whom they have killed innocently, or opening up the chest in Syria of a Syrian soldier after he has died, cutting out the heart and chewing on it. This is not minhaj al-Nabi. This is not sunnah of Rasulullah. This is the sunnah of Jahiliyyah. This is the sunnah of Banu Umayyah. This is the Sufiani tradition and not Nabavi or Alavi tradition. We have to maintain that difference. We have to maintain that moral ground and let the people know that if you really want to know the sunnah of Rasulullah, the Islam of Rasulullah, you have to look at the example of Amir al-Mu'minin Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. Another group known as Khawarij. This was a problem created in Siffin when Muawiyah used the Quran on the spearheads, deceived these Iraqis who came to the point of threatening Ali that will kill you unless you accept the Quran. The same Ali had offered the Quran before and they rejected. He even said to Muawiyah, send the message that why do you want to spill the blood of people, my people and your people? Why don't you and me come on the battleground? Fight it out. If you don't want Quran, let us fight. But me and you, let me settle the issue. But he knew on the basis of Quran, he'll be defeated, and even through Zulfiqar, he will be defeated. But when he was being defeated in the battle, that's where he uses the Quran to deceive these Iraqis at that time, the people from Kufa. We're talking about the people of that time, so Iraqis here, don't be offended. We are not talking about present ones. The way we had the fiasco with the Eastern Madrasa remarks, that was 1400 years ago. And so when we talk about this issue, we have to realize that the same people who forced Ali to accept arbitration and tahkim were the same people then regretted what happened. And they said, oh, we have become kafir because we accepted the arbitration of human beings against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so we are doing tawbah. And they came to Ali and you also have become kafir. You do tawbah, otherwise we are against you. And this is the group of Khawarij. And they are, Ibn Muljim was one of them. And this is where we see, you know, this whole mentality of labeling the people as kafir. You know, this is where we see that when you look at the Salafis, Wahhabis, their ideological ancestors are the Khawarij. It's from there that this idea comes in. Anyone who doesn't agree with us, kafir, or munafiq, or this and that. MashaAllah, even Shias are being inflicted with this disease. Very easily people, you know, use labels against one another. And we have to be careful about this. It is not only confined to them, it can come up even within. Be very careful before using labels, you know, against the people. The Khawarij, they actually became a nuisance for Amir al-Mu'mineen. They used to come inside the masjid, disturb namaz jamaat of Amir al-Mu'mineen. They would not even pray with Amir al-Mu'mineen. When he is doing namaz jama'at, they will start reciting ayat of Quran, taunting him by using those ayat. But Amir al-Mu'mineen was silent. Sometimes even in khutbas, they will stand up and say things against him, use slogans. There were times when he would respond, but many times he would just ignore them. Once he actually publicly made a statement about them, and he says, as long as there are three things, I will be with you. In a sense, I will tolerate you. Number one, and as long as, you know, when we talk about tolerating you, we will accept you, we will not prevent you from the masajid to come and do namaz. We will not deprive you from the Baytul Maal, the public treasury. وَلَا نُقَاتِلُكُمْ حَتَّى تَبْدَعُونَ As long as you are not raising your hands against us, as long as you're just protesting and saying things against us, we will allow you to come inside the masjid. We will give you from Baytul Maal. And we will never initiate hostilities against you until you start that first against us. And then when we see this, basically this is, you know, what the people talk about democracy. You have a group which doesn't like Amir al-Mu'mineen. Not only that, they don't like his policies. They actually, na'uzu billah, call him a kafir. They say, you have become a mushrik. They would actually come with an argument. They will say, oh, you were very good. You were the first Muslim, and you did this, and you did that. In Laylat of Hijrat, you were there. You were at the forefront of the battles. You did every good thing. But then they bring an ayat of Quran where Allah says, if you do shirk, all the good deeds are null and void. So they say, whatever you have done is useless now because you've done shirk by accepting arbitration in Siffin. And Amir al-Mu'mineen used to sit down and say that you do not understand what is the reality. You were the one who forced me to accept it. Even if I accepted it unwillingly, still not a guna or a sin for me. That you are talking about shirk and kufr, that is even very far away. But he still tolerated that. And this is democracy. What is democracy other than, you know, tolerating the opposition and whatever they are saying about you, as long as they do not become violent. Once they become violent and they become, you know, nuisance for the society, disrupt the law and order, of course the Amir al-Mu'mineen has to deal with them. And there also, if you look at the battle, you will see that Amir al-Mu'mineen is, you know, tolerant and forbearing with them as he was with the people at Jamal. Salawat upon the Akbar. Even Ibn Muljim, I mentioned this incident yesterday. Khawarij ke saath bhi Amir al-Mu'mineen ka jo bartao tha. Ibn Muljim ko jaante the. Shahadat ke kuch din pehle ka waqia hai ke Baytul Maal ki taqseem ho rahi thi. Log line mein khade hue the apne hisse ke liye. اور علی کی نظر جاتی ہے ابن ملجم کی طرف اپنے ایک صحابی سے کہتے ہیں اريد حياته ويريد قتلي کہ ہم اس کی زندگی چاہتے ہیں لیکن یہ ہماری موت چاہتا ہے تو صحابی نے کہا کہ اگر یہ بات ہے تو امیر المومنین اسے گرفتار کریں آپ لیکن بات وہی ہے خداوند عالم ہمارے بارے میں سب کچھ جانتا ہے ہم کیا کرنے والے ہیں جانتا ہے لیکن کبھی بھی سزا نہیں دے گا جب تک ہم اپنے عمل نہ کریں اور پھر حساب کتاب ہوگا قیامت کے دن اپنے علم کی بنیاد پر سزا اور جزا کا تصور نہیں ہے ورنہ وہ خلاف عدل بات ہو جائے گی امیر المومنین کے پاس علم غیب تھا لیکن علم غیب کو امپلیمنٹ کرتے تھے کبھی بھی اپنے ذات کے لیے نہیں اور ہمیشہ عدل و انصاف کے اصول کے مطابق جانتے ہوئے بھی اسے بیت المال سے بھی محروم نہیں کیا ہے مسجد کوفہ میں امیر المومن کو معلوم تھا کس مقصد کے لیے آیا ہے ضربت لگائی ہے اس نے لیکن اس کے باوجود بھی خارجی ہوتے ہوئے بھی امیر المومنین کے اس عدل و انصاف کے جذبے کو آپ دیکھیں کہ جب امیر المومنین کو ضربت لگنے کے بعد لحاف میں لٹایا گیا اور گھر والے اور قریبی اصحاب اٹھا کے امام کو لے جاتے ہیں, اس شجیر بہادر کے لیے کتنی تکلیف دے, وہ مراحل ہوں گے مسجد سے گھر تک کے. وہ بندہ جو کسی کا محتاج نہیں تھا, کسی نے کہا کسی کا سہارا نہیں لیا ہے, لیکن آج وہ ضربت کا اثر تھا کہ علی اپنے قدم سے مسجد سے گھر تک نہیں آ سکے. گھر کے قریب جب پہنچتے ہیں, آپ نے سنا کل رات کو کہ امام نے اپنے گھر والوں سے کہا, امام حسن سے کہا کہ صحابہ سے کہہ دو کہ اب اور قریب نہ آئیں, اس لیے کہ آپ جانتے ہیں کہ بیٹے تو مسجد پہنچ چکے تھے, بابا کی حالت کو دیکھا تھا, لیکن جن بیٹیوں نے وہ آواز سنی تھی لقد قتل علی المرتضی, یہ آواز جب سنی تھی اور آسمان میں گونجی تھی, زینب ام کلثوم اور دوسری بچیوں کی کیفیت کیا رہی ہوگی, بس وہ خدا جانتا ہے, وہ جانتے ہیں, علی جانتے تھے کیا کیفیت ہے, اس لیے اصحاب کو منع کر دیتے ہیں قریب نہ آئے. وہ نہیں چاہتے تھے بیٹیوں کی آواز جو ہے دوسروں تک پہنچے. عجب نہیں یہ اشارہ تھا کہ دیکھو ایک وقت میری بیٹیاں آئیں گی, آج وہ شہزادی ہیں لیکن کل جب آئیں تھی تو قصی اسیر اور قیدی بن کے آئیں گی. میری مہربانی کا خیال کرنا, میری بیٹیوں پر رحمت کے ساتھ پیش آنا. عزداران حسین, امام گھر میں آتے ہیں, بچیوں نے چاروں طرف سے گھیر لیا, بابا کی کیفیت کو دیکھتی ہے رونا شروع کر دیتی ہے. عزداران حسین, تھوڑی دیر کے بعد اسبق بن نباتا کی روایت ہے کہ میں نے اعلان تو سنا تھا مولا کا, لیکن دل نہ مانا کہ امام سے دور رہے. میں گھر کے باہر دروازے کے پاس بیٹھ چکا تھا, تھوڑی دیر میں بچیوں کی رونے کی آواز اور بڑھ جاتی ہے. جب عورتوں کی آواز بڑھی, اسبق سے صبر نہ ہو سکا, وہ بھی رونے لگے. ان کی آواز کو امام حسن نے جب سنا ہے, باہر آ کے کہتے ہیں اسبق بابا کے حکم کو نہیں سنا. اسبق کہتے ہیں شہزادے مولا سے اجازت چاہے ایک بار اور زیارت کرنا چاہتے ہیں. امام اندر جاتے ہیں, علی اسبق کی محبت سے واقف تھے, اجازت دیتے ہیں اندر آنے دو. جب آتے ہیں اسبق کا بیان ہے, میں نے مولا کے قدموں کا بوسا لیا اور رونا شروع کر دیا. علی نے کہا اسبق اتنا مت رو, تمہارا امام اب راحت کی طرف جا رہا ہے, اللہ کی طرف جا رہا ہے. اسبق نے کہا کہ مولا ہم تو اپنے پر رو رہے ہیں, آپ کی سرپرستی اب اٹھنے والی ہے. امام کی جو کیفیت تھی, کوفہ کے ایک طبیب کو بلایا گیا, اس نے آ کے جب زخم کا معائنہ کیا, وہ کہتا ہے مولا آپ وصیتیں شروع کریں, اس لیے کہ زہر جو ہے مغز تک پہنچ چکا ہے, اس کا کوئی علاج نہیں. عزداران حسین, آپ جب تاریخ تشیع کو دیکھتے ہیں, ہمارے 11 امام سب کے سب شہید ہیں, زیادہ تر کو زہر سے شہید کیا گیا ہے, حسین کو تلوار سے شہید کیا گیا تھا, لیکن ہائے علی زلو ضربت بھی لگی, اس تلوار میں زہر بھی لگا ہوا تھا. یہ دونوں طریقے سے علی کو شہید کیا گیا ہے. طبیب نے گھر والوں کو کہا علی کے لیے خوراک کے طور پہ صرف دودھ دیا جائے. عزداران حسین, آغا کافی مرحوم ایران کے بہت ہی مشہور خطیب تھے,
وہ ایک واقعہ بیان کرتے ہیں کہ جب یہ خبر پھیلی ہے کہ طبیب نے کہا ہے کہ علی سوائے دودھ کے علاوہ کچھ نہیں کھا سکتے ہیں، خبر یہ ملتی ہے کہ چھوٹے بچوں کو جب ان کی ماں دودھ کا پیالہ دیتی تھی، ان بچوں کے دل میں بھی علی کی اتنی محبت تھی، یہ لوٹا دیتے تھے اور کہتے تھے کہ ہم یہ پیالیا لے کے علی کے گھر جانا ہے، مولا کو ہمیں نثار کرنا ہے۔ عدداران حسین، علی نے وصیتیں شروع کی، وصیتوں کو بیان کرنے کے بعد حسین اور امام حسن اور کربلا کے مصائب کو بھی بیان کیا، آخری وصیت بھی کرتے ہیں۔ آخر میں اکیس کی وہ صبح ہوتی ہے جہاں علی کی روح ملع اعلیٰ کی طرف پرواز کر جاتی ہے، یا علی یا وا محمدہ کا نعرہ بلند ہوا۔ علی کے جنازے کو غسل و کفن کے بعد گھر والوں نے اٹھایا، لیکن دو اور تابوت شہر کے مختلف راستوں سے بھیجے گئے، اور رات کی تاریکی میں یہ جنازہ صرف گھر والوں کے ساتھ اور قریبی اصحاب کے ساتھ اٹھا، اس لیے کہ یہ ڈر تھا اگر قبر کا نشان مل جائے تو خوارج قبر کو کھود کے بھی علی کے جسد کی بے حرمتی کریں گے۔ امام حسن اور حسین اور اسبق بن نباتا، ارساس بن سوہان اور دوسرے افراد جاتے ہیں، مولا کو دفن کرتے ہیں۔ ساسا نے قبر سے مٹی اٹھائی، اپنے سر پر بیٹھ ڈالتے ہیں، پھر ایک نوحہ پڑا ہے جس نے حسن اور حسین کو بھی رلایا، آج ہم پرسے کے طور پہ مولا کو صرف اتنا کہیں گے، آپ کے تابوت کو ادھر ادھر بھیجا گیا، قبر کو مخفی کر دیا گیا، لیکن آئے حسین، وہاں ایک علی زین العابدین تھا جو بابا کے لاشے کو کربلا میں بے گور کفن چھوڑ کے چلا۔ باتوں میں حسین